Welcome to Successful Philanthropy. I'm your host, Jean Shafiroff, and today's show is all about a subject many of us don't want to talk about. It's domestic violence. And with us today is Loretta Davis, the executive director of the retreat. And Loretta, thank you so much for joining us. And Loretta, this is a difficult subject. And I understand many, many Americans and many people around the world are subject to domestic violence or they're a perpetrator. Can you discuss this a little bit with our audience today?
Yeah, thank you for having me on. And yeah, I'd love to discuss it.
Happy to have you.
It gives us the opportunity, it gives me the opportunity to talk about something that is awkward for a lot of people to talk about. Domestic violence is really permeates every community. No community is exempt from that. It can happen to anyone.
On all economic levels, correct?
All socioeconomic levels. It happens, you know, we support clients, men, women, children, any gender preference or identity. It can happen to anyone. And because it keeps happening and the pandemic has made it even worse, we have prevention education and then we have direct services because it's not going away. So you need the prevention in schools, in libraries. So, you know, we start in third grade.
Education, correct?
Education, prevention education. And then we have services. And all our services are free, so we eliminate that barrier.
Now, when people think of domestic violence, they often think of physical abuse. But verbal abuse is also considered domestic violence. So if someone is very nasty or continually putting someone down in the home or berating them or bullying them, that also is domestic violence, correct?
Yes.
And do you treat that as well?
Yes, we do. I mean, there's so many forms of violence and abuse. So there's the physical, and those, you know, those are often our shelter clients who might come in the middle of the night and really need a roof over their heads. And there's psychological, emotional. There's also financial. So, you know, there's many different forms, and even though psychological and emotional abuse don't leave scars, they really leave an imprint on someone.
Well, they leave psychological scars, which is a bad thing and can affect someone and usually does affect an individual for the rest of his or her life. And so is abuse something that goes from one generation to the next generation to the next generation? I've always read that it's something, if it starts in your household when you're very young, chances are you'll grow up to be an abuser. And then when you have children, your family will be abusers. It's a vicious cycle.
Yeah.
This is what I've read. And how do we break that cycle?
So that's our mission, is to provide services and to break the cycle of violence. And the way you do that is with counseling, with education, with advocacy. I mean, it's important to discuss what's acceptable behavior, what's a healthy relationship, what's normal. That's why it's good to be with kids in school, you know, and talk about hands are not for hitting, you know, some of the boundaries and red flags that they can consider, and to, you know, consider speaking to somebody at school or an adult that you can trust. In order to break that, you have to show what's acceptable and what is normal. And you can do that. You can do that through counseling and through prevention education.
And if you teach children when they're very young that what they're seeing is not normal, then they learn and they understand, I think. And I guess the parents absolutely have to be involved in this educational process. And it's not always so easy, is it?
It isn't. And it can take time, but people can heal. You know, all our programs are trauma-informed because there's often trauma involved and it can take time. But, you know, when we work with children that have been abused or violated or there's been violence, we also work with the parent. We would like to work with the non-abusive and the abusive parent if we can, if that will work, because it's something that affects the whole family and you can't treat it in isolation.
Yes, I used to be on a domestic violence committee for a charity that I've been involved with for a very long time called the Jewish Board. And I am actually a Catholic, but I served on that board for 28 years, and now I'm an honorary board member. And what I learned was that the domestic violence is, like you said before, has nothing to do with economics, and the perpetrators often continue unless they're stopped. We actually had committees, or not committees, but there was a program within this committee for the perpetrators, and the perpetrators, meaning the people giving out the abuse, would have a weekly or bi-monthly session with a counselor, and that they would learn together that what they were doing was wrong. And I believe it was very effective. And I understand you're also involved in trying to work with the perpetrators to change their behavior. Is that correct?
Yeah, we have had the batterers program, and that's mandated by the courts. So those are for offenders who are mandated by the court to attend this 32-week program that we have. We're on hold for that program. We had it in the beginning of the year. We'll start it up again in 2021. But it's really effective because it's the Emerge program, and it really focuses on accountability. You have to participate in these classes. You're with other individuals who are in the same situation. And I think they've really helped with the recidivism. So meaning, you know, so they won't offend again.
Again and again. Their behavior. And that's what it's all about, to get someone to change their behavior if they're doing the wrong thing. Now, you have a center where people can live, or a home. And I understand it's in an undisclosed location, and that is to protect the people who are being abused, the families, from the abuser. And does that always work out?
You know, we have been very lucky. We've had, you know, no one's ever broken into our shelter. We've never had any kind of issue like that. The police are always very close by. They know where we are. We've had families there since the early 1990s. So, you know, it's really a safe home. So that's what people need, is a roof over their head. So we'll get people who will call our hotline. We have a 24-hour hotline. We've got a multi-language line. We also have sign language, so we have it a way that people can, there's a triage of three different people, and that's for the deaf and hard of hearing.
And what about the people that work for the retreat, the counselors and the staff? How are they trained? And I imagine it's a rather extensive training. And then how many people a year are you actually seeing come through your doors for counseling?
So we have, you know, in our locations in Suffolk County, we have a very talented professional group of individuals. We have about 60 employees. So we have professional counselors,
social workers.
We have advocates who go to court with the clients. We have legal assistants. We have attorneys. Mm-hmm. I'm an attorney myself, but I
yes,
don't go to court.
I understand you were a judge.
Yes. Yes. And I still get to use that title. That's one thing you still get. You could still be honorable. But we have attorneys. We have women who help our clients with financial empowerment. So they learn about credit. They learn about budgeting. We work with, you know, their resumes and help them with jobs. We also have case managers who are also MSWs, Masters in Social Work. And they also help our clients. So,
really wonderful work you're doing. And what about the children? Do they continue with school once they're placed in the home? Or what happens exactly?
Yes, it's a very smooth transition because of our child care coordinator. So if they're coming from another community, they go very easily into our local schools, and there's no disclosure. So there won't be any contact with the perpetrator. So, you know,
excellent.
And the schools are very accepting. And if they need special schools, they go to those schools. And it was interesting because during the pandemic, you know, in March, we had to switch over totally. All our services have been in person. And when the pandemic hit, we had to quickly
switch to virtual.
Yes. And, you know, we're still doing that. We still have, I mean, at the shelter, we see our clients and we have counseling in person. And, you know, we're going with our clients to court and we're accompanying them. And, you know, they have representation there. But many of our clients are getting counseling, you know, through video conferencing, through Zoom or... Mm-hmm.
And do you have many teenagers that go into the program who are in abusive relationships, sometimes with a boyfriend? And sometimes I know there are certain cultures who, if the man doesn't show or the partner doesn't show some aggression, it's not considered love. I don't understand this completely, but what about teenage counseling? Do you do that as well?
Yeah, it's sometimes it's crazy what teenagers hear and learn. So we have a fabulous teen leader workshop program where we meet with the teenagers in the fall. We have a program, it's about 6 weeks, and also we'll do that in the spring. And they get together now, it's through Zoom, and they have community projects. And they actually help us with some of the language that we use, recommended for like bystander intervention and things of that sort. You know, like they don't use the term dating anymore. They're like, what's that? You know, I mean.
What is the term?
I don't even know what they use. But, you know, it's like
seeing
they
somebody
go together. Yeah.
Go
yeah.
together. Okay.
Right. So our teen leadership program is really dynamic and engaging. And we have lots of kids who come to that. And they're really helpful. They become volunteers for us. And in fact, we have some interns, one who's at Stanford, who was part of the teen leadership program, and now she's an intern for us. We have one at Brown. So being remote there's been advantages because otherwise they couldn't be interns, you know, normally because they'd be too far away, but they can help us now by even being in other states. But what happens is they come to that program and then they might say, I don't know if I'm in a healthy relationship. Can I talk to a counselor about that?
And they evaluate everything they do.
Right. So then they get to get, they can, they have the opportunity to see a counselor.
This is Successful Philanthropy. We're talking to Loretta Davis, the executive director of the retreat. And Loretta, going back to the pandemic now, this has been really a terrible time for almost every single person on this planet, with the exception of maybe if you were in the food business or not in the restaurant business, but in the food supply business. And tell me, how has this pandemic, what has happened with domestic violence? Has it exacerbated it? Has it made it worse? Or is it about the same as it was before?
No, it's been really tough on victims or survivors because, you know, it's been tough for all of us, right? But imagine being home with someone who is very controlling and maybe violent, and you're trying to seek help. You're isolated, and it's really hard to reach out.
And that person could take away your computer, could take away all forms of communication. And at least when that person was at work, you had the person being abused had some time away from the abuser.
That's right. And they also had their network. You know, they would go out and they would have their friends or their family. But, you know, initially when we were mandated really to try to stay home and be isolated, that was really tough for survivors. And there was a time when our hotline calls went down. And then they started going up in April. And it's been really crazy this whole summer.
Very busy.
We've had a lot of clients. We've had... you know, we've had some younger clients. We've had more kids and more elderly because the elderly have been isolated and that might be with a healthcare worker or it might actually be with a family member. And those have been tough situations. So, you know, we've seen an increase in that. And it's tough. I mean, what we did in the spring for the first time is we started a chat platform that's web-based. So it's safer than texting. So if you go on our website, you can ask questions, you can get help. And that has definitely helped. We've gotten clients coming in that way. Because imagine being in the house and you can't talk. You're afraid someone's going to hear you. Even with some of the phone calls, we've had people say, you know, hang up, call again, saying, I'm out in the shed, call again. You know, it's just, it's scary. You know, it's really, there's a lot of control involved, and it's not
very upsetting
easy
to hear all of this. And my heart really goes out to anyone who's in an abusive relationship. And unfortunately, with all the problems that this pandemic has caused, financial problems and other types of problems, your numbers are up is what you're saying. And it's very, very hard. It's very sad to hear all of this. And now you are a 501c3. Where does your funding come from, and what is your annual budget like?
So that's, you know, that I'm really glad you asked that question, because it gives me the opportunity to thank our community. We've had like tremendous support this year. Our local community foundation was very helpful. They pooled resources and knowledge, and we were able to get a grant early on so that we could, our technology was archaic, and all of a sudden we had to have everyone home with their computers, and we had to get, you know, everything connected, and we needed headphones and all kinds of things. So we've had a lot of really strong local support, and we really appreciate that. Our budget is about $5 million, mm-hmm. and about half of that is from government grants mm-hmm. and contracts.
Yes.
The other half is really all from donors, foundations. It used to be events. We had a great event in the spring, but you know, we couldn't have any
fundraising events. Yes.
Yeah, that's those are a little tricky now. And I think people are getting zoomed out, so I don't know.
Yes. And so to our viewers, many charities, or not many, but quite a few receive government funding, and that doesn't mean that you shouldn't give to that charity, because in this case with the retreat, half of their budget comes from the government, and then the other half comes from individuals and businesses and different charitable foundations. And without that money, they couldn't do all that they do, and they could only service about half the people that they serve. And going back to some of your fundraising events, because hopefully in 2021, we will have a beginning of fundraising events, live fundraising events in the Hamptons and then elsewhere. Are you optimistic about being able to do something in person this summer, or are you not committing? I would imagine you're not going to commit. You're a lawyer. You probably don't commit to anything.
They never really, yeah. I'm hoping we'll have at least a hybrid, you know, something. Maybe we'll have smaller groups in person. I mean, it's so hard to know. This has gone on a little longer than we all thought.
A lot longer.
So, you know, we haven't really, you know, we're talking about that event, but you know, we had a good turnout for our spring virtual event. And, you know, we had some good support from some of our real supporters that people know. You know, in the past, we've had benefits out here with Gloria Steinem. Joy Behar is a big supporter. Don Lemon, Alan Alda, Mariska Hargitay. They've all really helped us and spoken out for us. And that helps. That helps.
Yes,
a lot.
It does, because when a celebrity lends their name to a charity, it can add a lot. And very often, a lot of celebrities donate a lot of money as well. And we should all be donating. And getting back to the counseling, you have an outpatient service, correct? So
yes.
In other words, for a family or a woman that can't get away, or maybe it's just the beginning of domestic violence, they can actually get counseling, and during non-COVID times, they can go somewhere to get the counseling. Is that correct?
Yes. We have counseling in Riverhead. We're going to have counseling in Hophog and also in East Hampton and in Southampton. And now we're doing most of that remotely.
Of course.
Either through video or through phones. And even, you know, people will be in our shelter for a number of months. And then, you know, we help them with jobs. We help them get housing. And then they transition to another community. When they do that, we continue our services. So we can still help them with advocacy, or if they have an issue with custody or protective orders, we get a lot of protective orders. And the counseling continues.
It's a shame it's so involved. It really is. And if people just treated one another with love and kindness, this would never happen. And what about volunteers? Do you accept volunteers? People always want to try to help out. Not everyone can write a check to a charity, but for many people, they have time and they may have a lot of knowledge too. What is your volunteer process like?
We are so lucky with the volunteers we have. We have incredible volunteers. So we have on our list of volunteers about 150 volunteers, but we have maybe 40 volunteers that help us more often than not, not just for events, which is key.
And what do they do? What kind of work is available to a volunteer besides working on an event?
Well, first of all our board members are volunteer.
Of course.
There's no financial benefit to that.
No, as a matter of fact, if you're on a charity board, you absolutely cannot do any business whatsoever with that charity. Remember that.
Yeah, right. But those are incredible volunteers. They're really involved and engaged. We have other volunteers who teach yoga at the shelter. We have others who do Reiki, others who help the kids at the shelter with tutoring. We have volunteers who help us with all our mailings that we do. We have volunteers who help with our education programs. We have volunteers who are interpreters. We have volunteers who are mentors and, you know, will help us with, you know, looking at our strategy. We have a lot of committees where people can help us. We have volunteers who help us with our volunteer orientation. Because if you wanted to volunteer, for instance, and you would take our volunteer orientation, you would meet all the managers and you'd meet some of the volunteers and they would tell you what it's like to work at the retreat.
And what about training?
So we have the volunteer orientation, which is about, now it's about 2 hours. And then depending which department you go into, there's more extensive training.
And I assume you carefully vet your volunteers because you are putting these volunteers in very serious positions. And they have to be
the right
people.
They're all fingerprinted.
Well, fingerprinted, but you want to make sure they know what they're doing and that they don't cause any problems.
That's right. That's right. It has to work to be able to work at a domestic violence agency. So we do. We've been very lucky. And we also have people. We have a thrift store, which also generates some income.
And where is that?
So that's in Bridgehampton Commons. It's across from TJ Maxx. And you can get some great finds in there.
I think I'll take a little drive over there.
Yeah, we get, you know, we have great clients that, you know, great customers who come in and donate things. And, you know, the stores have been very generous. And so we've gotten some new merchandise. But I think the fun about a thrift store is that you can go in and find a treasure, you know, something from the 60s or 70s, which who knows why we would want to wear that. But, you know, we do sometimes.
Well, everyone loves a bargain. And now.
Right.
Especially when they know it's helping,
right.
Because I assume everything in the thrift shop wasn't bought, but it was all donated. So
it's donated.
Wonderful.
It's all donated. And that's another place to volunteer. We always need volunteers to help sort items or even if you want to volunteer and work there. And we get a lot of donations at the shelter and we need help with that. Some of our volunteers work with the kids. Sometimes we need people to drive. So during COVID, that's changed a little bit, but we always take volunteers who actually drive our clients to the thrift store where they have a stipend and they can get, you know, like $200 worth of items over the course of their stay. So this way they get to shop and get, you know, do something fun. And
well, we have just about a minute left. And what advice would you give to our listeners? And then I want your website for donations, if you would please give that to our viewers. And you've been amazing, really. And thank you for the great work. But what is the three things you would advise to families?
I would say know that there's hope and there's help, that you're not alone. And it's not your fault, you know, that, you know, the retreat is there. And I would say to all our donors and to our community that we survive on the generosity of our volunteers and our donors. We really do. So,
and what is the website?
So it's allagainstabuse.org. shafiroff.org.
And that's the retreat's website for giving.
Yes.
allagainstabuse.org. Your work is really so special and so needed. And on that note, I hope I see you again soon, and thank you. And this concludes Successful Philanthropy. I'm your host, Jean Shafiroff. I'll see you next week.